Chapter 1 of The Stolen Bacillus and Other Stories, M.D. The Stolen Bacillus and Other Stories by H.G. Wells. The Stolen Bacillus. "This again," said the bacteriologist, slipping a glass slide under the microscope, "is a preparation of the celebrated bacillus of cholera, the cholera germ." The pale-faced man peered down the microscope. He was evidently not accustomed to that kind of thing, and held a limp white hand over his disengaged eye. "I see very little," he said. "Touch this screw," said the bacteriologist. "Perhaps the microscope is out of focus for you. Eyes vary so much, just the fraction of a turn this way or that." "Ah, I see," said the visitor. "Not so very much to see after all. Little streaks and shreds of pink, and yet those little particles, those mere atomies, might multiply and devastate a city. Wonderful." He stood up and, releasing the glass slip from the microscope, held it in his hand toward the window. "Scarcely visible," he said, scrutinizing the preparation. He hesitated. "Are these alive? Are they dangerous now?" "Those have been stained and killed," said the bacteriologist. "I wish, for my own part, we could kill and stain every one of them in the universe." "I suppose," the pale man said with a slight smile, "that you scarcely care to have such things about you in the living, in the active state." "On the contrary, we are obliged to," said the bacteriologist. "Here, for instance," he walked across the room and took up one of several sealed tubes, "here is the living thing. This is the cultivation of the actual living disease bacteria," he hesitated, "bottled cholera, so to speak." A slight gleam of satisfaction appeared momentarily in the face of the pale man. "It's a deadly thing to have in your possession," he said, devouring the little tube with his eyes. The bacteriologist watched the morbid pleasure in his visitor's expression. This man, who had visited him that afternoon with a note of introduction from an old friend, interested him from the very contrast of their dispositions. The lank black hair and deep gray eyes, the haggard expression and nervous manner, the fitful yet keen interest of his visitor, were a novel change from the phlegmatic deliberations of the ordinary scientific worker with whom the bacteriologist chiefly associated. It was perhaps natural, with a hearer evidently so impressionable to the lethal nature of his topic, to take the most effective aspect of the matter. He held the tube in his hand thoughtfully. "Yes, here is the pestilence imprisoned. Only break such a little tube as this into a supply of drinking water, say to these minute particles of life that one must needs stain and examine with the highest powers of the microscope, even to see, and that one can neither smell nor taste, say to them, go forth, increase and multiply, and replenish the cisterns, and death, mysterious, untraceable death, death swift and terrible, death full of pain and indignity, would be released upon this city, and go hither and thither seeking his victims. Here he would take the husband from the wife, here the child from its mother, here the statesman from his duty, and here the toiler from his trouble. He would follow the water mains, creeping along streets, picking out and punishing a house here and a house there, where they did not boil their drinking water, creeping into the wells of the mineral water makers, getting washed into salad and lying dormant in ices. He would wait, ready to be drunk in the horse troughs, and by unwary children in the public fountains. He would soak into the soil to reappear in springs and wells at a thousand unexpected places. Once start him at the water supply, and before we could ring him in and catch him again, he would have decimated the metropolis." He stopped abruptly. He had been told rhetoric was his weakness. "But he is quite safe here, you know, quite safe." The pale-faced man nodded. His eyes shone. He cleared his throat. "These anarchist rascals," said he, "are fools, blind fools, to use bombs, when this kind of thing is attainable, I think." A gentle rap, a mere light touch of the fingernails, was heard at the door. The bacteriologist opened it. "Just a minute, dear," whispered his wife. When he re-entered the laboratory, his visitor was looking at his watch. "I had no idea I had wasted an hour of your time," he said. 12 minutes to 4. I ought to have left here by 3:30. But your things were really too interesting. No, positively, I cannot stop a moment longer. I have an engagement at 4. He passed out of the room reiterating his thanks, and the bacteriologist accompanied him to the door and then returned thoughtfully along the passage to his laboratory. He was musing on the ethnology of his visitor. Certainly the man was not a Teutonic type, nor a common Latin one. "A morbid product, anyhow, I'm afraid," said the bacteriologist to himself. How he gloated on those cultivations of disease germs! A disturbing thought struck him. He turned to the bench by the vapor bath, and then very quickly to his writing table. Then he felt hastily in his pockets, and then rushed to the door. "I may have put it down on the hall table," he said. "Minnie!" he shouted hoarsely in the hall. "Yes, dear," came a remote voice. "Had I anything in my hand when I spoke to you, dear, just now?" Pause. "Nothing, dear, because I remember—" "Blue ruin!" cried the bacteriologist, and incontinently ran to the front door and down the steps of his house to the street. Minnie, hearing the door slam violently, ran in alarm to the window. Down the street, a slender man was getting into a cab. The bacteriologist, hatless and in his carpet slippers, was running and gesticulating wildly towards this group. One slipper came off, but he did not wait for it. "He has gone mad," said Minnie. "It's that horrid science of his," and opening the window would have called after him. The slender man, suddenly glancing round, seemed struck with the same idea of mental disorder. He pointed hastily to the bacteriologist, said something to the cabman, the apron of the cab slammed, the whip swished, the horse's feet clattered, and in a moment cab and bacteriologist, hotly in pursuit, had receded up the vista of the roadway and disappeared round the corner. Minnie remained straining out of the window for a minute. Then she drew her head back into the room again. She was dumbfounded. "Of course he is eccentric," she meditated, "but running about London in the height of the season, too, in his socks?" A happy thought struck her. She hastily put her bonnet on, seized his shoes, went into the hall, took down his hat and light overcoat from the pegs, emerged upon the doorstep, and hailed a cab that opportunely crawled by. "Drive me up the road and round Havelock Crescent, and see if we can find a gentleman running about in a velveteen coat and no hat."
"Velveteen coat, ma'am, and no hat. Very good, ma'am."
And the cabman whipped up at once in the most matter-of-fact way, as if he drove to this address every day in his life. Some few minutes later, the little group of cabmen and loafers that collects round the cabman's shelter at Haverstock Hill were startled by the passing of a cab with a ginger-colored screw of a horse driven furiously. They were silent as it went by, and then as it receded,
"That's 'Arry 'Icks. What's he got?"
said the stout gentleman known as Old Tootles.
"He's a-using his whip, he is, to right," said the ostler boy. "Hallo," said poor old Tommy Byles. "Here's another bloomin' lunatic, blowed if there ain't."
"It's old George," said old Tootles, "and he's drivin' a lunatic, as you say. Ain't he clawin' out of the keb? Wonder if he's after 'Arry 'Icks." The group round the cabman's shelter became animated. Chorus.
"Go it, George, it's a race. You'll catch him. Whip up."
"She's a goer, she is," said the ostler boy.
"Strike me giddy," cried old Tootles. "Here I'm a-goin' to begin in a minute. Here's another comin'. If all the kebs in Hempstead ain't gone mad this morning."
"It's a field mail this time," said the ostler boy.
"She's a-following him," said old Tootles. "Usually the other way about."
"What's she got in her hand?"
"Looks like a eye at."
"What a bloomin' lark it is. 3-1 on old George," said the ostler boy.
"Next!"
Minnie went by in a perfect roar of applause. She did not like it, but she felt that she was doing her duty, and whirled on down Haverstock Hill and Camden Town High Street with her eyes ever intent on the animated back view of old George, who was driving her vagrant husband so incomprehensibly away from her.
The man in the foremost cab sat crouched in the corner, his arms tightly folded, and the little tube that contained such vast possibilities of destruction gripped in his hand. His mood was a singular mix of fear and exultation. Chiefly he was afraid of being caught before he could accomplish his purpose, and behind this was a vaguer but larger fear of the awfulness of his crime. But his exultation far exceeded his fear. No anarchist before him had ever approached this conception of his. Ravachol, Vaillant, all those distinguished persons whose fame he had envied, dwindled into insignificance beside him. He had only to make sure of the water supply and break the little tube into a reservoir. How brilliantly he had planned it, forged the letter of introduction and gotten to the laboratory, and how brilliantly he had seized his opportunity. The world should hear of him at last. All those people who had sneered at him, neglected him, preferred other people to him, found his company undesirable, should consider him at last. Death! 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 They had always treated him as a man of no importance. All the world had been in a conspiracy to keep him under. He would teach them yet what it is to isolate a man. What was this familiar street?
Great St. Andrew's Street, of course.
How fared the chase? He craned out of the cab. The bacteriologist was scarcely 50 yards behind. That was bad. He would be caught and stopped yet. He felt in his pocket for money and found half a sovereign. This he thrust up through the trap in the top of the cab into the man's face. "More," he shouted, "if only we get away." The money was snatched out of his hand. "Right you are," said the cabman, and the trap slammed, and the lash lay along the glistening side of the horse. The cab swayed, and the anarchist, half standing under the trap, put the hand containing the little glass tube upon the apron to preserve his balance. He felt the brittle thing crack, and the broken half of it rang upon the floor of the cab. He fell back into the seat with a curse, and stared dismally at the two or three drops of moisture on the apron. He shuddered. "Well, I suppose I shall be the first. Phew! Anyhow, I shall be a martyr. That's something. But it is a filthy death, nevertheless. I wonder if it hurts as much as they say." Presently a thought occurred to him. He groped between his feet. A little drop was still in the broken end of the tube, and he drank that to make sure. It was better to make sure, at any rate. He would not fail. Thus it dawned upon him that there was no further need to escape the bacteriologist. In Wellington Street, he told the cabman to stop and got out. He slipped on the step, and his head felt queer. It was rapid stuff, this cholera poison. He waved his cabman out of existence, so to speak, and stood on the pavement with his arms folded upon his breast, awaiting the arrival of the bacteriologist. There was something tragic in his pose. The sense of imminent death gave him a certain dignity. He greeted his pursuer with a defiant laugh. "Vive l'anarchie! You are too late, my friend. I have drunk it. The cholera is abroad." The bacteriologist from his cab beamed curiously at him through his spectacles. "You have drunk it, an anarchist, I see now." He was about to say something more and then checked himself. A smile hung in the corner of his mouth. He opened the apron of his cab as if to descend, at which the anarchist waved him a dramatic farewell and strode off toward Waterloo Bridge, carefully jostling his infected body against as many people as possible. The bacteriologist was so preoccupied with the vision of him that he scarcely manifested the slightest surprise at the appearance of Minnie upon the pavement with his hat and shoes and overcoat. "Very good of you to bring my things," he said, and remained lost in contemplation of the receding figure of the anarchist. "You'd better get in," he said, still staring. Minnie felt absolutely convinced now that he was mad, and directed the cabman home on her own responsibility. "Put on my shoes?" "Certainly, dear," said he, as the cab began to turn and hid the strutting black figure now small in the distance from his eyes. Then suddenly something grotesque struck him, and he laughed. Then he remarked, "It is really very serious, though." You see, that man came to my house to see me, and he's an anarchist. No, don't faint, or I cannot possibly tell you the rest, and I wanted to astonish him, not knowing he was an anarchist, and took up a cultivation of that new species of bacterium I was telling you of, that infest, and I think cause the blue patches upon various monkeys. And like a fool, I said it was Asiatic cholera. And he ran away with it to poison the water of London, and he certainly might have made things look blue for this civilized city. And now he has swallowed it. Of course, I cannot say what will happen. But you know it turned that kitten blue, and the three puppies in patches, and the sparrow bright blue. But the bother is, I shall have all the trouble and expense of preparing some more. Put on my coat on this hot day? Why? Because we might meet Mrs. Jabber? My dear, Mrs. Jabber is not a draft. But why should I wear a coat on a hot day because of Mrs.? Oh, very well. End of chapter 1.
Chapter 2 of The Stolen Bacillus and Other Stories. The Stolen Bacillus and Other Stories by H. G. Wells. The Flowering of the Strange Orchid. The buying of orchids always has in it a certain speculative flavor. You have before you the brown, shriveled lump of tissue, and for the rest you must trust your judgment, or the auctioneer, or your good luck, as your taste may incline. The plant may be moribund or dead, or it may be just a respectable purchase, fair value for your money, or perhaps, for the thing has happened again and again, there slowly unfolds before the delighted eyes of the happy purchaser, day after day, some new variety, some novel richness, a strange twist of the labellum, or some subtler coloration, or unexpected mimicry. Pride, beauty, and profit blossom together on one delicate green spike. And it may be even immortality, for the new miracle of nature may stand in need of a new specific name, and what so convenient as that of its discoverer, John Smithia. There have been worse names. It was perhaps the hope of some such happy discovery that made Winter Wedderburn such a frequent attendant at these sales. That hope, and also maybe the fact that he had nothing else of the slightest interest to do in the world. He was a shy, lonely, rather ineffectual man, provided with just enough income to keep off the spur of necessity, and not enough nervous energy to make him seek any exacting employments. He might have collected stamps or coins, or translated Horace, or bound books, or invented new species of diatoms. But as it happened, he grew orchids, and had one ambitious little hothouse. "I have a fancy," he said over his coffee, "that something is going to happen to me today." He spoke as he moved and thought, slowly. "Oh, don't say that," said his housekeeper, who was also his remote cousin. For something happening was a euphemism that meant only one thing to her. "You misunderstand me. I mean nothing unpleasant, though what I do mean I scarcely know. Today," he continued after a pause, "Peters are going to sell a batch of plants from the Andamans and the Indies. I shall go up and see what they have. It may be I shall buy something good unawares. That may be it." He passed his cup for his second cupful of coffee. "Are these the things collected by that poor young fellow you told me of the other day?" asked his cousin as she filled his cup. "Yes," he said, and became meditative over a piece of toast. "Nothing ever does happen to me," he remarked presently, beginning to think aloud. "I wonder why. Things enough happen to other people. There is Harvey. Only the other week, on Monday, he picked up sixpence. On Wednesday, his chicks all had the staggers. On Friday, his cousin came home from Australia, and on Saturday, he broke his ankle. What a whirl of excitement compared to me." "I think I would rather be without so much excitement," said his housekeeper. "It can't be good for you." "I suppose it's troublesome. Still, you see, nothing ever happens to me. When I was a little boy, I never had accidents. I never fell in love as I grew up, never married. I wonder how it feels to have something happen to you, something really remarkable." "That orchid collector was only 36, 20 years younger than myself, when he died. And he had been married twice and divorced once. He had had malarial fever 4 times. And once he broke his thigh. He killed a Malay once, and once he was wounded by a poisoned dart. And in the end, he was killed by jungle leeches. It must have all been very troublesome, but then it must have been very interesting, you know, except perhaps the leeches. I am sure it was not good for him, said the lady with conviction. Perhaps not. And then Wedderburn looked at his watch. 8:23. I am going up by the 11:45 train, so that there is plenty of time. I think I shall wear my alpaca jacket. It is quite warm enough, and my gray felt hat and brown shoes, I suppose. He glanced out the window at the serene sky and sunlit garden, and then nervously at his cousin's face. I think you had better take an umbrella if you are going to London, she said in a voice that admitted of no denial. There's all between here and the station coming back. When he returned, he was in a state of mild excitement. He had made a purchase. It was rare that he could make up his mind quickly enough to buy, but this time he had done so. There are vandas, he said, and a dendrobe, and some phalaenopsis. He surveyed his purchases lovingly as he consumed his soup. They were laid out on the spotless tablecloth before him, and he was telling his cousin all about them as he slowly meandered through his dinner. It was his custom to live all his visits to London over again in the evening for her and his own entertainment. I knew something would happen today, and I have bought all these. Some of them, I feel sure. Do you know that some of them will be remarkable? I don't know how it is, but I feel just as sure as if someone had told me that some of these will turn out remarkable. That one, he pointed to a shriveled rhizome, was not identified. It may be a phalaenopsis, or it may not. It may be a new species, or even a new genus, and it was the last that poor Batten ever collected. I don't like the look of it, said his housekeeper. It's such an ugly shape. To me, it scarcely seems to have a shape. I don't like those things that stick out, said his housekeeper. It shall be put away in a pot tomorrow. It looks, said the housekeeper, like a spider shamming dead. Wedderburn smiled and surveyed the root with his head on one side. It is certainly not a pretty lump of stuff, but you can never judge of these things from their dry appearance. It may turn out to be a very beautiful orchid indeed. How busy I shall be tomorrow. I must see tonight just exactly what to do with these things, and tomorrow I shall set to work. They found poor Batten lying dead or dying in a mangrove swamp, I forget which, he began again presently, with one of these very orchids crushed up under his body. He had been unwell for some days with some kind of native fever, and I suppose he fainted. These mangrove swamps are very unwholesome. Every drop of blood, they say, was taken out of him by the jungle leeches. It may be that very plant that cost him his life to obtain. I think none the better of it for that. Men must work, though women may weep, said Wedderburn with profound gravity. Fancy dying away from every comfort in a nasty swamp. Fancy being ill of fever with nothing to take but chlorodyne and quinine. If men were left to themselves, they would live on chlorodyne and quinine, and no one round you but horrible natives. They say the Andaman Islanders are most disgusting wretches, and anyhow they can scarcely make good nurses, not having the necessary training, and just for people in England to have orchids. I don't suppose it was comfortable, but some men seem to enjoy that kind of thing, said Wedderburn. Anyhow, the natives of his party were sufficiently civilized to take care of all his collection until his colleague, who was an ornithologist, came back again from the interior, though they could not tell the species of the orchid and had let it wither, and it makes these things more interesting. It makes them disgusting. I should be afraid of some of the malaria clinging to them. And just think, there has been a dead body lying across that ugly thing. I never thought of that before. There, I declare, I cannot eat another mouthful of dinner. I will take them off the table if you like, and put them in the window seat. I can see them just as well there. The next few days he was indeed singularly busy in his steamy little hothouse, fussing about with charcoal, lumps of teak, moss, and all the other mysteries of the orchid cultivator. He considered he was having a wonderfully eventful time. In the evening, he would talk about these new orchids to his friends, and over again he reverted to his expectation of something strange. Several of the Vandas and the Dendrobium died under his care, but presently the strange orchid began to show signs of life. He was delighted, and took his housekeeper right away from jam-making to see it at once, directly he made the discovery. "That is a bud," he said, "and presently there will be a lot of leaves there, and those little things coming out here are acral rootlets." "They look to me like little white fingers poking out of the brown," said his housekeeper. "I don't like them." "Why not?" "I don't know. They look like fingers trying to get at you. I can't help my likes and dislikes." "I don't know for certain, but I don't think there are any orchids I know that have acral rootlets quite like that. It may be my fancy, of course. You see, they are a little flattened at the ends." "I don't like 'em," said his housekeeper, suddenly shivering and turning away. "I know it's very silly of me, and I'm very sorry, particularly as you like the thing so much, but I can't help thinking of that corpse." "But it may not be that particular plant. That was merely a guess of mine." His housekeeper shrugged her shoulders. "Anyhow, I don't like it," she said. Wedderburn felt a little hurt at her dislike to the plant, but that did not prevent his talking to her about orchids generally, and this orchid in particular, whenever he felt inclined. "There are such queer things about orchids," he said one day, "such possibilities of surprises. You know, Darwin studied their fertilization and showed that the whole structure of an ordinary orchid flower was contrived in order that moths might carry the pollen from plant to plant. Well, it seems that there are lots of orchids known, the flower of which cannot possibly be used for fertilization in that way. Some of the cypripediums, for instance, there are no insects known that can possibly fertilize them, and some of them have never been found with seed. But how do they form new plants?" "By runners and tubers and that kind of outgrowth. That is easily explained. The puzzle is, what are the flowers for?" "Very likely," he added, "my orchid may be something extraordinary in that way. If so, I shall study it. I have often thought of making researches, as Darwin did, but hitherto I have not found the time, or something else has happened to prevent it. The leaves are beginning to unfold now. I do wish you would come and see them." But she said that the orchid house was so hot it gave her the headache. She had seen the plant once again, and the acral rootlets, which were now some of them more than a foot long, had unfortunately reminded her of tentacles reaching out after something, and they got into her dreams, growing after her with incredible rapidity, so that she had settled to her entire satisfaction that she would not see that plant again, and Wedderburn had to admire its leaves alone. They were of the ordinary broad form, and a deep, glossy green, with splashes and dots of deep red towards the base. He knew of no other leaves quite like them. The plant was placed on a low bench near the thermometer, and close by was a simple arrangement by which a tap dripped on the hot water pipes and kept the air steamy. And he spent his afternoons now with some regularity, meditating on the approaching flowering of this strange plant. And at last the great thing happened. Directly he entered the little glass house, he knew that the spike had burst out, although his great Phalaenopsis lowii hid the corner where his new darling stood. There was a new odor in the air, a rich, intensely sweet scent that overpowered every other in that crowded, steaming little greenhouse. Directly he noticed this, he hurried down to the stream.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.